Miss Ritwika, I know some of you are awesome musicians, and all you need is a good quality music video to get the attention of big record labels. Today, I'll show you how you can get studio quality vocal music recording at your own home with the low budget, without any expensive or complex equipment or software. So if your music video sounded like this,
where you are seems to be as far as an eternity. Outstretched arms, open heart, and if it never ends, then when do we start?
After watching my tutorial, it'll sound like this.
Where you are seems to be as far as an eternity. Outstretched arms, open heart, and if it never ends, then when do we start?
For this tutorial, I've deliberately kept my setup very simple. I have a microphone, an MP3 player, a mixer, headphones, and a good quality audio digital recorder. I'll show you how this simple setup can give you outstanding results. Before I go into the details of the recording setup and the process, I want to show you my setup. Here I've connected my mic and my MP3 player to the mixer. I've also connected my headphones over here so I can listen to the recording mix while singing. And the general output of this mixer goes to my digital audio recorder, which actually records my song. Now I'll discuss each and every component of the setup with you and help you choose the right mic, mixer, etc., etc. for yourself. Let me start with microphones. Microphones are the most critical component of your recording setup. This is because it's the first machine that converts your voice into an electrical signal. So if you use a cheap karaoke mic, you won't get good sound recording no matter how expensive your other equipments may be. Picking a good mic is very confusing to begin with. That's why singers often end up with many mics. I'm no exception. I have many mics which I use in different specific situations. I'll try to tell you the important points you'll need to know in selecting the perfect mic for you. There are many different microphone technologies. Among them, two are extremely popular for sound recording. A large diaphragm condenser microphone and a dynamic microphone. Dynamic microphones are live performance mics. That's because they have lower sensitivity and a very hardy construction. Lower sensitivity is not at all a bad thing for these mics because it allows you to hold it while you're singing and it won't pick up any annoying handling noises or the sound from background singers. Internally, these mics are built like tiny headphone speakers with a voice coil, diaphragm, and a magnet. When you sing into them, the voice coil and the diaphragm vibrate in a magnetic field and produce a feeble electrical signal, which is then preamplified and recorded. These microphones generate its own electrical signal, so it doesn't need an external power supply. Condenser microphones are essentially recording studio mics. They're extremely sensitive and very fragile in construction. So if you handle your dynamic mic like a tennis ball, you should handle this one like an egg. Due to extreme sensitivity, you can't hold it while singing. You have to mount it in a microphone stand with a shock mount and a pop filter. Put in a shock, well actually my shock mount is a bit bigger than my microphone, so I wrap the foam around it, open the clamp, and put it in there. The shock mount suspends the microphone with its elastic thread, so it's somewhat isolated from the vibrations from the floor. Otherwise, the mic would pick up any creaking on the floor or footsteps. The microphone also picks up bursts of air whenever you say P's or T's. The pop filter is just a stretched fabric screen which sits between the singer and the microphone and takes away these bursts of air and eliminates the pops. Condenser microphones get their name from electronic component condenser, or capacitor. It's actually a relic capacitor with a metal plate and a very thin metallized diaphragm, which are placed very close together. When an external voltage is applied to it and we sing, the diaphragm vibrates and it creates a difference in capacitance. This creates an electrical signal in the condenser and is then recorded. So to make this microphone work, we need to give it an external voltage supply. The power supply that does this is called phantom power. Most mixers or preamplifiers like these already have this inbuilt. Here, I'm turning on my phantom power over here, and it's powering my mic over here. Now let's decide which mic is best for you. The dynamic mic will produce a very warm sound even with less air. This is like seeing a photoshopped image of a model in a magazine. The condenser mic will pick up every little detail like breathing or sibilance in the sound and give a very detailed, airy, and sparkly sound. It's like watching a close-up of an HD movie in a big HD TV. This mic, the dynamic one, can be used in a relatively noisy environment, but the condenser one needs absolute silence. Bottom line, if you do not have access to an extremely silent room, you're better off with the dynamic mic. I love my dynamic mic, the Shure Beta 58A. If I had to choose between all my mics and could just keep one, I'd choose this one, because my voice sounds the best in it. However, everyone's voice sounds a little different in different mics, so what mic sounds best with my voice may not sound the best in yours. For a large diaphragm condenser microphone, I use the MXL V67i. This actually has two condenser microphones back to back. One diaphragm faces this way and gives a bright tone, and the other one faces this way and gives warm tone. Once again, I just want to say that, you know, what mic may work the best for me may not be the best for you. So do your own research before buying the mic. Oh, one word of caution. If you're planning to buy a large diaphragm condenser mic, make sure you don't record loud sounds with it, like subwoofers, kick drum, etc., etc. That's because a loud sound shockwave can push the diaphragm to stick to the back plate and kill the microphone for good. I cannot stress more the importance of buying a good quality microphone cable, which will connect your microphone to the preamp. A cheaper cable will cause impedance mismatch, introduce humming, and destroy your high-frequency sound. The brand which I use and recommend is Megami. It's pricey, but definitely worth it. Next, we have the mixer preamp. It has two specific purposes. First, it amplifies the microphone signal with no appreciable distortion and noise and supplies 48 volt phantom power to the condenser mic. Secondly, it has multiple inputs that take in signals from various sources and mixes them together. In our case, we'll mix vocal track with a karaoke track for monitoring and recording. Before buying a preamplifier, I always look at its signal-to-noise ratio. It is the ratio of the sound we want to record to the unwanted noise the preamplifier produces. A good preamplifier produces very little noise, and a bad one produces lots and lots of noise. You want the ratio to be at least 100 dB or higher. I have selected the Behringer 1202 FX Mixer Preamp. It has 4 XLR inputs, and in total, 12 inputs overall. It also has various inbuilt effects like reverb, echo, flanging, etc., etc. It is a great value for its money, as it's under $100. Now let's talk about stereo monitoring headphones. I have some bad news for you. You can't use your super fancy bass-enhanced headphones like my Bose and Audio-Technica. You'll have to get professional quality ones, like my Sony MDR-7506. The reason you need these monitoring quality stereo headphones is because they provide a flat response from low to high frequencies. This way you can get the true sound and make an accurate mix. I'll not go too much into MP3 players because any MP3 player will do, even the cheap ones or even your cell phone. Lastly, you will need a good quality digital audio sound recorder. I use the Sony PCM-D50. Its sound quality is unparalleled and I use it all the time. Zoom also released an inexpensive recorder under $100 called Zoom H1, which has almost identical specifications like its big brother Zoom H2. Check it out. Now that we have all of our equipment ready, let's connect everything and set up our home recording studio. First, connect your microphone to the XLR input of the mixer. This is the center channel of the mixer, so when I sing, my voice will be heard in both the left and right channels. then connect your MP3 player, which has the karaoke track, to only the left input. That way, the right channel will only have my vocal tracks. Then connect the headphone to the headphone out, and connect the digital audio recorder to the mixer out. To adjust the mixer, turn all the gain controls to zero. Then turn on your MP3 player and set the volume so it doesn't go over 0 dB. Then set your microphone as well by turning on your phantom power if you're using a condenser mic and then singing into it to check the levels. Then set your mic gain level accordingly, low, low, so you can hear it in your stereo monitoring headphones in both channels. Hello, 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 hello. And once again, check that it doesn't go over 0 dB. Okay, now we're ready to rock and roll. Turn on your recorder, set the levels, and start singing.
Seems to be as far as an eternity. Outstretched arms, open hearts. And if it never ends, then when do we start? I'll never leave you behind or treat you unkind. I know you understand. Oh, and with a tear in my eye, give me the sweetest goodbye to receive. Pushing forward.
Now that we're done recording, we have to connect the recorder to a computer and transfer the recording files. We'll mix the tracks together using a digital audio workstation software, or DAW. If you don't have one, you can download a great free open source software called Audacity. Let me quickly show you how to do a simple mix in Audacity. This is the Audacity screen, and here are the two sound files. This is my recording at PCM D50, and this is the original high-quality karaoke track. I will now mix only my voice with the high-quality karaoke track. First, I drag my recording in Audacity. You can see it has recorded the karaoke track in one channel, and my voice in both channels. I am now dragging the karaoke track to Audacity. I will now manually synchronize the karaoke track with my recorded track by visually aligning them. Zoom in so that you can see the details of the waveforms. Now select the time shift tool and visually align them. Zoom further to get an accurate sync. Quickly play and listen to the sync. If they are perfectly aligned, the karaoke track should sound just normal. If the recording track and the karaoke track are not synced, you will hear a reverb-like effect. Now I split the recording track into two mono tracks, and I delete the accompaniment track. So we are now left with my vocal as a mono track and a perfectly synchronized karaoke track. Now it is time to adjust the vocal volume level so that it is loud and clear against the karaoke track. At this point, you save the project. Now add some equalization, compression, and other audio effects as per your taste. I will not go into that detail, as it's a huge, huge subject. So play with various effects and tone control and reverb to make your mix sound gorgeous. Once you're satisfied, export your mix in a WAV or FLAC file format. This will be your master file, so you can use it to make your MP3 file or a CD, or even make a lip-synced YouTube music video. If you enjoyed today's tutorial, please consider supporting Renaissance Now, a 501c3 public charity. You can donate a dollar or even your used arts and craft tools. Your contribution will help us provide free training and tools to thousands of underprivileged artisans around the world.